United Nations Deputy High Commissioner for Human Rights, Flavia Panzieri, says that the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights regrets the position of the Sri Lankan government. She made this statement presenting the oral update of the High Commissioner for Human Rights on the progress of the investigation on Sri Lanka at the UN Human Rights Council in Geneva today. Exercising Sri Lanka's right of reply, Permanent Representative Ravinatha Ariyasinghe said the government of Sri Lanka's opposition to the investigation is more justified today than it was in March this year.
We therefore very much regret the government's position specifically on the resolution and would like to encourage it to keep its channels open. Indeed, this investigation is a unique opportunity to establish an accurate record of patterns of human rights violations and related crimes alleged to have been committed by both sides during the latter part of the conflict. In this context, the ongoing campaign of threats, harassment, intimidation, and reprisals by both state and non-state actors since March against civil society groups, human rights defenders, and victims' organizations, including those engaging with the international inquiry, is deplorable. This climate of intimidation and threat constitutes a real challenge for the investigation mandated by the Human Rights Council. It also undermines the prospects for Sri Lanka's own domestic investigations, where witness and victim protection has long been a concern.
GSL's opposition to the OHCHR investigation would seem even more justified today than it did at the time the resolution 25/1 was carried in late March 2014. For over the past 6 months, the operationalization of this resolution has clearly violated both the letter and spirit of the said resolution. Let me draw to this Council's attention several grave anomalies in the conduct of this investigation. It has gone beyond a time frame. It has expanded the scope and subject of discussion. In contravention of provisions of the PBI, the OHCHR has decided to appoint 3 high-level individuals instead of 2. By aid of high-level international figures who are by no means technical experts relevant to the investigation, it seems that the OHCHR has sought to tacitly elevate the level of the OHCHR investigation to mimic an international COI.
Let me also say that the government has made commendable progress in resettlement and reconstruction. A more fundamental and far-reaching accountability process, which addresses both past and ongoing violation, however, is indispensable for Sri Lanka to come to terms with its past, to end impunity, to achieve reconciliation between communities, and to strengthen the rule of law. I therefore appeal once again to the authorities to cooperate fully with the investigation as well as with the relevant special procedures in the long-term interest of all people of Sri Lanka.
In recent weeks, we have heard many countries in this Council express concern about the increasing trend to assign the Office of the High Commissioner with extensive investigative roles. Such arbitrary and selective action, especially with respect to what is clearly a politically motivated and highly politicized issue in the Council, giving disproportionate and unwarranted attention to Sri Lanka, is left, if left unchecked, not only calls into question the credibility of the functioning of the OHCHR and OHCHR-led processes, but also creates dangerous precedents. With all the calamities and afflictions around us today, Sri Lanka is clearly not a situation that requires the urgent and immediate attention of this Council. What Sri Lanka needs at this juncture is to be encouraged, not impeded.
We strongly support the independent international investigation into allegations of violations on both sides of the conflict. We welcome the expert team established by the High Commissioner and are confident that the team can deliver the robust investigation needed. Any genuine domestic accountability process should welcome information arising from the international investigation as a further contribution to establishing the truth. We call on the government to cooperate with the investigation and ensure that those who wish to engage with it are able to do so freely without fear of intimidation, harassment or prosecution.
We are of the view that it is desirable for every country to have the means of addressing human rights violations through robust national mechanisms. The Council's effort should be to provide technical assistance to them to develop the necessary institutions for this purpose. We believe that engaging the country concerned in a collaborative and constructive dialogue and partnership is a more pragmatic and productive way forward. We take positive note of Sri Lanka's engagement with the UN human rights mechanisms, despite its non-recognition of the recent resolutions adopted by the Council on Sri Lanka. Madam Vice President, we note with concern that the High Commissioner has not indicated how he intends to proceed with this investigation in the absence of cooperation from the country concerned. The composition of the OSCHR investigating team, its work methodology and sources of funding have not been shared with this Council. We would urge the High Commissioner to do so in order to maintain the credibility of this report.
In spite of many difficulties, the Sri Lankan government has been open to cooperation with the international human rights mechanisms. China commends Sri Lanka for these efforts and calls upon the international community to show respect and support to Sri Lanka's national reconciliation effort. We believe this will contribute to the country's economic and social development as well as to the equal enjoyment of human rights by all Sri Lankans.
The willingness of the Namibian people to embrace national reconciliation after independence has brought about peace in the country, but we needed to be given time and space to build trust and healing. It is for that reason that the international community should not impose solutions on Sri Lanka, but that it should encourage the national process, which will be amenable and lasting.
We therefore believe that the intrusive mandate given to the OHCHR by Resolution 25-1 to carry out investigations on Sri Lanka is unwarranted, especially in the context where the country is implementing its own domestic processes.
Russia has consistently spoken against the examination in the Human Rights Council of Sri Lanka. We do not see any objective justification for this. We cannot agree with the majority of conclusions and evaluations we have heard today. We consider that the activities of the so-called OHCHR mission falls outside the mandate of the OHCHR and amounts to unjustified interference in the domestic affairs of the country.